Recorded Books presents The Wishing Pool and Other Stories by Tananarive Due, narrated by William DeMeritt and Jasmin Walker. Introduction. I love writing short stories. I've been publishing novels since 1995 and writing screenplays for 20 years. But in many ways, short stories feel like my purest fiction. Several of these stories feature young protagonists, as in my previous collection, Ghost Summer. I enjoy writing children in horror in particular, perhaps because childhood has so many harrowing moments that haunt us throughout our lives. I also learn so much from young protagonists about how to accept new realities and confront them with imagination and courage. But a thread of aging and mortality is also woven through this volume, starting with the titular story, The Wishing Pool. When I first began publishing horror, I had not yet experienced the worst traumas of my life, losing my mother and grandmother. As of this writing, my father, freedom lawyer John Due, is 87 years old and experiencing dementia. I wrote the story The Wishing Pool in the wake of the COVID-19 pandemic, when I was about to see him for the first time in nearly 2 years, and I was bracing for signs of his decline. I asked myself what was more important to me, the former trappings of our relationship or his own happiness. It's a question I still wrestle with, but writing this story helped prepare me emotionally for that visit. In real life, my visit with my father went much better than Joy's visit with hers. I'm sure that most of the characters in these stories, like Joy, are different versions of me, or I'm bringing my fears to life in fantastic, impossible ways, or I'm conjuring answers to questions I can only confront through stories. Of course, every attempt doesn't work. Sometimes I'll sketch a few lines or a couple of pages, and somehow the ember isn't strong enough to forge a full story. The premise isn't interesting enough, or the world never comes into focus for me. The biographer is based on a premise I toyed with as an unpublished writer with a day job as a reporter at the Miami Herald and dreams of becoming an author. Back then, I remember feeling so frustrated that some ideas were too big for my life experience. But the time for the biographer is finally right. Several of the pandemic stories in this collection were written before COVID, including Attachment Disorder and Ghost Ship. But like my protagonist in the biographer, I suppose I thought it was possible that a pandemic would strike, or it represented one of my worst nightmares. Last Stop on Route 9 is a title I borrowed from a story I wrote while I was an undergraduate at Northwestern University. In my original story, a white traveler stops at a gas station reeling from an unidentified illness. That was pretty much the whole story. In those days, as a creative writing student learning from the canon, I lost sight of myself as I began writing contemporary realism about white male protagonists having epiphanies. Not genre, not Black women. The first short story I sold right after college, Amusement, also featured a white male protagonist. Gloria Naylor's Mama Day taught me that a Black woman could be respected writing Black characters and the metaphysical. A chance telephone interview with Anne Rice for the Miami Herald in 1992 taught me to lean into horror with pride. My rewritten version of Last Stop on Route 9 is a racism as the monster story that feels like a reclamation of my voice. Times are also very different now than when I first began testing my skills as a writer. With a growing respect for the late Octavia E. Butler, the rise of Jordan Peele, and a slew of talented writers of all races and ethnicities, no speculative fiction syllabus would be complete without a much broader spectrum of voices. I didn't discover Butler's work until after the publication of my first novel, The Between, 1995, so writing that story was an act of faith that I could find an audience that would appreciate Black horror. Now, young writers of all kinds can see themselves reflected in genre fiction, yet the rise of Afrofuturism in particular, science fiction, fantasy, horror, comics, and magical realism in fiction, has opened a whole new world of opportunities. I feel so fortunate to share these stories with you as a member of a growing community of writers who need to add a dash of magic and mayhem to their stories. Whether they take place in the future, the past, or the present, my most authentic voice, usually horror, sometimes a dash of science fiction too, is present in every single one. Part 1. Wishes. The Wishing Pool. Joy nearly got lost on the root-knotted red dirt path of Highway 99, losing sight of the gaps between the live oaks and Spanish moss that fanned across her hood and windows like fingertips. Driving back to her family's cabin 20 years later reminded her that the woods had rarely been restful for her. Once, Dad had made her play outside instead of sitting on the couch with her Virginia Hamilton books, and she'd stepped in an anthill up to her shin. She howled so loudly from the vicious stinging that Dad and Mom heard her all the way from the lake, and when they reached her, they expected to find her half dead. She'd never forgotten that wild, frightened look in their eyes. No, Joy did not like the woods. If she'd started her trip closer to dark, she would have had to turn around and wait out the night at the overpriced Hampton Inn off I-10. Like her father, she didn't want to sleep alone at her parents' main house in the ashes of her childhood 10 miles back toward civilization. But her father's old Bronco finally appeared in the glare of orange dusk light fighting through the treetops, parked in front of the cabin. And the cabin looked so small, much smaller than she remembered. The trees and wildly growing ferns dwarfed it, with no obvious path to the door from the red-brown dirt driveway. She'd imagined that she and her brother might fix the cabin up as a rental one day. But in real life, it was puny and weather-beaten and sad, more relic than residence. Their great-grandfather built this cabin in the 1920s to hide from lynch mobs roused by their envy that a Negro businessman could afford a shiny new Ford Model T. Every inch of the cabin was sagging 100 years later, weary of standing. The slanted roof had collected a thick blanket of dead leaves at the heart of the L shape that separated the cabin's main room from its single bedroom. The bathroom her parents had added in the rear in the 90s wasn't in great shape, Jessie had warned. But it was better than the outhouse she still saw a few yards beyond the cabin, its wood blackened with age. How had Dad been living there alone for 2 months? Maybe longer if her brother's theory was true, that he'd moved into the cabin soon after Mom's funeral a year ago. Almost to the day. How? She said aloud. Gaps between the wall's wooden slats gaped like missing teeth, so the cabin probably had no insulation just when the weather was getting cold. Joy was wearing a jacket and it wasn't dark yet. North Florida wasn't New York, where she lived now, but it wasn't South Florida either. The temperature was dipping to the 40s at night. Jessie had warned her to bring extra blankets to supplement the coal stove, which was still the main heating source. The cabin looked abandoned, but dim light bled through the threadbare curtains she recognized in the window, the ones with patterns of fish Mom had found at a garage sale with Joy a million years ago. Or yesterday. Time was a mystery and a lie since Mom had died. Joy was glad that Dad wasn't waiting outside, since she might have forgotten to prepare herself to see him look smaller too, thinner, more frail, grayer. Jessie had warned her what to expect after his visit a week ago, the reason she was here. But she might have forgotten if the cabin had looked anything like she remembered it. Joy checked her cell phone. No signal. Shit. No wonder Dad never picked up his cell phone. Jessie said he'd made an appointment to install a landline, but the technician couldn't come for another 30 days. She wished she could call Jessie now. She was a year older, but he was a better fit for this job. He'd been deployed in Afghanistan most of Mom's last year with cancer, so Joy was the one who had cleaned and fed her and raged at negligent nurses. They both knew it was Jessie's turn now. She could not have faced another round of nursing home applications and medical assessments on her own, not so soon. Jessie had already taken Dad to a neurologist in Jacksonville to confirm the dementia they already suspected before Mom died. But Jessie's last visit had worried him so much that he'd promised Joy he would drive from Jacksonville to stay with Dad in the cabin every weekend. He just wanted to be sure she didn't think Dad needed more than that. All he'd asked from Joy was one weekend. Stay there in the cabin with them a couple nights, he'd said. Observe his life. Let's compare notes on what we think we should do. Then Jessie had held her forearm and stared her in the eye. But he loves it out there, Joy. He really wants to be in that cabin. That's the only thing that makes him happy. If she'd realized what Jessie really meant, she would not have come alone. Joy heard her father's terrible cough before she reached the door. For a couple of years, Joy had a friend during their family visits to the cabin. It turned out that a white family lived in a lake house only a quarter mile away, an easy walk if you knew where to look. The two kids were miraculously close to their ages, a daughter, Natalie, who was 10 like Joy, and a son, Nate, who was only a year older than Jesse. For two summers and two winters, Joy and Natalie had tried every way they knew to entertain themselves in the woods, collecting tadpoles, tracking butterflies, kicking over ant mounds in vengeance, whittling figures from fat twigs, smoking cigarettes Natalie stole from her mother, anything that wasn't fishing. Natalie was the one who told her about the wishing pool, which was midway between their properties, nestled between two ancient live oaks that bent toward each other as if to hug. It was more like a puddle than a pool, Joy had always thought, maybe 6 feet across, so shallow that the green-brown water only reached their knees. Although Natalie cautioned against ever touching the water. "It's for wishes," Natalie said. "Touching the water ruins them." For their first wish, they kept it simple. They wished for a dog. They didn't think it through exactly. They didn't live together or even see each other outside of short visits, so they didn't have a clear picture of what that joint dog ownership would look like. But the next morning, when Joy was arguing with her brother over who had to wash the dishes piled in the cabin's tiny sink, she heard a happy bark outside. She rushed to the window and saw Natalie with a grin that filled her face. A black and white dog, coat a bit muddied, as if just maybe it had crawled out of the wishing pool, was running in circles around Natalie. Just like that, they had their dog. Dad said it looked like a terrier mix of some kind, 100% pure mutt and filthy at that, but they were ecstatic. No caller identified an owner who might be looking for him, so the dog was theirs. They named him Lucky because, well, the obvious. Lucky fetched sticks no matter how far they threw them, helped them sniff out rabbit holes, barked protectively at any strange rustlings, and generally made everything they did 10 times more fun. They washed, combed, and groomed him until he looked like he belonged on TV. They worked out a joint custody arrangement with their parents. Natalie would keep Lucky until the Christmas visit to the cabin, and then Joy could take him until summer. But none of that happened. The day Joy was scheduled to go home, Natalie knocked on the cabin door teary-eyed and said Lucky had crawled out of her house and wouldn't come when she called. From the moment she heard, Joy knew the dog was gone. She wasn't surprised to learn on her next visit that Natalie had never seen Lucky again. She decided their wish had not been specific enough. They should have said they wanted a dog to keep. Natalie had changed in the 6 months Joy had been away. A bit thinner, not smiling as much, bored with tadpoles and butterflies. The wishing pool had shrunk too. Only half its previous size, the water more brown than green. Joy assumed they would wish to bring Lucky back, but Natalie just shrugged and said she didn't want a dog anymore. "My wish is for my parents to get a divorce," Natalie said. That wish was unimaginable to Joy. But Natalie said her parents fought so much that she'd rather they split up and get separate houses. She'd mapped it all out. 2 Christmases, 2 summer vacations, guilt presents. So Natalie threw the shiny penny in the pool, closed her eyes and said, "Please let my parents split up." Joy was both scandalized and thrilled. The secret felt better than smoking. But the wish didn't come true, at least not right away. The next summer, when Joy knocked on Natalie's door, a tenant answered and said they had sold the house after the owner was killed by a drunk driver. "Natalie?" Joy had said, hardly able to speak. The tenant soothed her. "No, honey. The little girl and her mom are fine. They lost the daddy, though." "Please, let my parents split up," Natalie had said. As an adult, Joy told the story often with a breezy air, never confessing how she'd walked far out of her way to avoid the wishing pool ever since. How maybe it was the wishing pool, not the boredom of fishing, that had soured her on visiting the cabin with her parents after she graduated from high school. How the wishing pool had ended her childhood.
"Joya,"
Dad said, the nickname he'd made up for her. He grinned, his teeth unchanged, stripping 30 years from his face. That would be her happiest memory of this visit. His eyes bright with surprise and delight when he called her by the name that belonged to him alone. Then another cough came. Terrible. swaying him until he steadied himself against the doorframe. He sounded winded despite the cannulas in his nostrils, tubes snaking to rest heavy in a pocket of his robe. He was wearing piss-stained long underwear and a threadbare robe. Joy wanted to burst into tears. Somehow, she didn't, leaning in for a casual hug. She was relieved that the nape of his neck smelled the same. She clung to every grace. "Surprise, Dad!" She hadn't realized how good an actress she was. Jesse hadn't told her the most important thing. Dad was dying. Maybe Jesse was hiding it from himself. She'd seen plenty of death up close with Mom, so she knew it when she saw it. The shriveled frame, the dark shadows beneath his eyes, that cough. How could Jesse have left Dad like this even for a day? If she'd had a phone, she would have called for an ambulance already.
"Well, why the heck didn't you call when you got to town?" Dad said. "I'm a mess. I would have."
He surveyed himself.
"Done better, pumpkin."
He coughed a river of phlegm. She took his arm, so thin, and led him back inside, nudging the door closed with her heel so no heat would escape. The coal stove glowed golden orange through the grate, but it must be burning embers. The front room was cold, so his bedroom must be frigid. She wanted to take out a notebook and start making a list of the urgent things he needed. Heat, clothes, medicine. Chronicling it in her head dispassionately kept her lip from trembling. "I'll help you put a few clothes in your bag. Then I need to take you to a doctor." Dad waved an impatient hand over his shoulder before he opened the stove's door and stirred the dying coals.
"I'm not going to talk about that."
Joy's silence finally wore him down. They had always had a kind of telepathy, weathering Mom's and Jesse's emotional storms with telling glances.
"I've already seen the doctors, Joya. There's nothing I can do. It just has to play out. That's that. Ask your brother. We're not going to talk about it."
So Jesse did know more. Probably had heard a diagnosis. She'd fought so hard not to be irritated at Jesse, but now she was furious. Jesse was doing it again. He was hiding behind her. Dad's hands had been waving above the coal bin so long that she realized he had forgotten his task. "Let me light that," Joy said. "It's freezing in here, Dad." She'd sounded scolding like Mom would have. They both heard it. The enormity of Mom's absence rocked through them. Dad looked down at the coal, hiding misty eyes, and shrugged.
"Not cold to me. Do what you want. Jesse was always cold, too. Jesse was just here, you know, a few days ago."
"He told me." That was almost all he told her.
"Anything you want to know, ask him. Jesse's got it. Under control."
He coughed with a mighty struggle for breath.
"Dad, don't talk. You're wearing yourself out."
She helped him sit down in the wobbly wooden chair at the table, cupping his elbow. The ritual evoked a vivid image of helping Mom sit down to eat her last meal before they took her to the hospital she never came home from. Joy's hand shook less when she dug into the coal bin and savored the rough texture of the coal, which was running low. A puzzle of finding the matches. A miracle of flame. A thought made her nearly gasp with hope.
"Is the phone hooked up?"
Dad reached into the pocket of his robe to pull out his cell phone, as shiny as new.
"Not your cell, Dad. Jesse said he called the phone company." "Don't know anything about that," Dad wheezed.
"I'm sorry, don't try to talk." She checked his cell anyway, but it was dead. She wondered when he'd last charged it and decided it was probably ages ago, because her father had dementia. Hope, once spent, had exhausted her. Her situation flared into harsh focus again. "Okay," she said in a down-to-business tone that made her own ears prick, eager to hear the plan.
"First, we need to warm it up in here. Then I'm going to bring in my bag."
Dad had a stack of newspapers piled on one end of the sofa, but she could clear it to sleep. She'd forgotten to bring extra blankets, so she probably could find some. If she meditated, she might be able to sleep, eventually.
"You're staying?"
"Tonight, yes." That was the simplest thing. His coughing had stopped, so it might not be the emergency she'd feared. The cabin was cold, but not frigid. The gaps in the planks had been patched with drywall. Jesse's work, she guessed. The kettle and saucepan were on the stove, and she saw a stack of soup cans in the cabinet, ordered by type with military precision. Jessie again. She always traveled with a bag of protein bars, so she had plenty for breakfast and lunch, enough to share. Maybe Jessie really did have it under control. The idea of a night's sleep, putting off tomorrow, elated her. And she saw the tears shining in her father's brown eyes. Dad, what's wrong? He shook his head, staring at the bright orange glow of the stove. She waited, so he finally said,
I'm forgetting her. Your mother?
You'll never forget Mom, she said before she could think. And the look he gave her was a lashing, as if she had betrayed his honesty with lies. Some part of you will always...
Horseshit, he said. I can't remember a thing. If I took my meds, if I ate...
He spoke the final word painfully.
Have I bathed? I could take all of that, but... Now it's Patricia I'm forgetting. I can't remember your mother's middle name.
The confession wrenched him. Jessie probably doesn't know it either.
That's different, he said. He didn't know her since she was 16. He didn't grow up down the street from her. He's not one of the only ones left who should know.
Dad was so upset that he was shaking. His trembling loosed a coughing fit that made her doubt her plan to let him stay the night. His cough sounded like it needed a hospital. Her middle name is Rose, Joyce said. Is, not was. And Dad closed his eyes like the name was a devotion. She rubbed his back. His bones felt so frail. And his coughing eventually stopped. She was glad to see that the tiny kitchen's faucet still worked. The well water tasted fresh when she tested a sip before handing him the glass.
Yes, Rose, he wheezed when he could speak. Patricia, Rose, Brian.
Mom's name before she got married. He repeated it several times. He found a pad on his table and wrote with the pen tied to it with a rubber band. Patricia, Rose, Brian, in jittery script. She saw other words and phrases he'd written. Jaden and Jordan, Jesse's children. 10-2-32, his birth date. She flipped the page and saw he'd filled the other side with his reminders. And the next page, he was harvesting his memories, collecting them one by one, catching them while he could. Had he filled the entire notebook?
Dad,
Joy said gently,
do you know that sometimes people die of a broken heart?
It's bad enough that we lost her, but you can't do this to yourself every time you can't think of something right away. Can you let yourself heal a little bit?
Heal,
he spat the word. You're torturing yourself, she said. You can't live like this. You've turned Mom into a kind of ghost haunting you. She wouldn't want that. It's all right to let some of it go.
Sometimes, Dad said. I can't remember her smile, Joya.
Then he buried his face in his arms on the tabletop and sobbed, which led to a spate of coughing so severe that she was ready to carry him to her car if she had to. But then it stopped, and Dad went to his bed to sleep propped up on a mound of pillows sitting up. Yet he slept. Her cell phone told her it wasn't even 7 o'clock. The sky had not darkened yet. Joy remembered the wishing pool. She found herself looking for the trail with the powerful flashlight she kept in her emergency pack in the trunk of her car. Much of the woods were overgrown and unrecognizable years later, though she knew to veer right after the outhouse. So she waded through the underbrush and tried to find any hints of the trail. She never did, but she did see the twin live oaks, still standing, eerily unchanged, their trunks colored bright gold in the waning daylight. A beacon calling to her almost. When she reached the tree, she was sure the wishing pool would have dried up, but it hadn't. It barely looked like a puddle anymore, covered in leaves, but dark brown water still peeked through in that spot and only that spot. Joy wanted to test its depth with her foot, but she remembered what Natalie had said about tainting it with touch. So she didn't. Thinking about Natalie was almost enough to change her mind, but not quite. Joy reached into her back pocket for the change she'd shoved there after she broke a 20 at a McDonald's on the road. A shiny penny gleamed in her flashlight beam. She pressed it between her fingertips until the copper was warm, her heart speeding up. The last time she had stood in this spot, Mom had been alive, back in the cabin with Dad. How could this physical place still exist when the life it was tied to was gone? "Please," she said aloud to the night woods. "Just let my father be healthy and happy." She tossed her penny into the murky water just beyond the edge of a drowned leaf and watched until it sank out of sight. She waited for the surge of certainty she'd felt as a child that magic was humming around her. Instead, while crickets whirred in a fever, she could only remember Natalie's dead father and his salt and pepper beard. She wondered if Natalie had blamed herself for his death and felt certain she had. Joy wanted to plunge her hand into the puddle and retrieve her penny, but she told herself she was being silly, since wishes weren't real. Or she might ruin her wish if she touched the water. Or both. The short walk back to the cabin was harrowing because it had gotten dark so fast, but Joy was grateful to return to a warming room and the sound of her father snoring safely in his bed. No coughing. She touched his forehead. No fever. Could the wish that couldn't possibly work be working already? She didn't believe it. The wanting to believe made her smile at herself. Smiling made everything easier. She cleared off the sofa, found fresh blankets in the cedar-scented trunk at the foot of Dad's bed, beside two large oxygen tanks she tried not to notice, and chanced upon a package of almond M&M she didn't know she had in her purse. She was asleep as soon as she rested her head. The cold room only made her sleep harder, and she dreamed a kaleidoscope of her childhood. Lively meals and talent shows and beach days. She woke up in the daylight feeling better rested than she had in weeks, swaddled under a mound of blankets. The first thing she heard was the silence. No snoring. No coughing. No sound at all. She kicked off her blankets and jumped up to look into the bedroom's open doorway. Dad's bed was empty. His blankets on the floor. She barely squeezed out the thought, "Where the hell is..." And then she heard a chopping sound outside, an axe splitting wood. She'd forgotten how Dad used to chop piles of wood, more than they needed since coal burned long. He said swinging his axe made him feel like John Henry. But now? Joy ran outside barefoot, ignoring her cold toes and the prickling and poking against her bare soles. A pine cone stabbed her foot so sharply that she was sure it drew blood. She hopped the rest of the distance to find Dad in the shadow of the outhouse. The axe raised high above his head, his back turned. He arced his swing and cleaved the wood chunk in half. Then he laughed. Not his polite chuckle he forced out to put her at ease. A deep belly laugh she was sure would make him cough. But it didn't. He heaved in a breath before he swung the axe again, and his lungs sounded strong and clear. Healthy. He laughed again. Happy. Adrenaline tingled Joy's skin. "Be careful," she said. "Should you be exerting yourself like that?" Dad whirled around, startled. His smile withered when he saw her. He stared, eyes flat. "Help you?" he said. "Very funny." But his eyes stayed flat. His smile stayed gone. Joy's stomach cramped. "It's Joy. Joya." When he heard his nickname for her, recognition flared in his eyes, but oh so tepid. He studied her features the way he would a painting in a museum, mildly curious. "Joya," he said. He nodded. He took one step closer to her, another. He spoke directly into her eyes. "Pleased to meet you. You remind me of someone." His smile returned, perhaps the one he'd flashed for her mother when he spotted her raking leaves in her yard that day he passed on his bicycle when they were both 16 and he had just moved to her street. Or perhaps it was the smile he'd worn the first day he held Joy in his arms, still slick from Mom's womb. Soon Joy couldn't see his smile for her tears. She only heard the sharp chop of the wood and her father's strong huff of breath as his laughter and liberation rang in the treetops.
Paint in the window. They walked in with a gale of authority, the bells on the door jangling with a ferocity that made you jump and feel guilty, even if you'd only spent the morning arranging to rent chairs for next week's Terry McMillan book signing. Daryl noted their flanking formation, one on one side, one on the other, as they eased inside the bookstore, their hands never far from their waistbands, fingers never far from their triggers. Maybe that was how they had moved when they served in Afghanistan or wherever else they had moved on the lookout for targets. Daryl had noticed the uniforms through the window long before the door opened, but he kept his eyes down on his seating chart just the same, as if they hadn't shaken those bells loud enough to wake the dead. Fucking security guards. A salt and pepper team like Lethal Weapon or 48 Hours in his store with such an imperious air, his store except on the deed anyway. Sir? When Daryl looked up, the black security guard who was closest smiled an irritated smile worse than a frown. The white one kept a distance as if he were waiting for Daryl to pull out a sawed-off from underneath his counter. His head tilted slightly down, eyes angled upward. Meant to look scary, maybe, but he was only 5'8", so Daryl, who was 6 feet, wasn't scared. They looked like they were serving a warrant. Daryl had to remind himself they weren't really cops, and that he'd never been served a warrant in his life. He managed a damn bookstore. Yeah? Daryl finally answered when he figured they had waited long enough. A couple was mugged down at the intersection today. Daryl waited for the part that had something to do with him. The white security guard went on, trying to enlist Daryl's indignation. New residents at the Gardens? The Gardens? Daryl almost laughed at the nickname for the former eyesore he'd walked past his whole life. Residents had been begging for a new paint job for 20 years, but new paint only came with the reopening, the evictions. We're keeping an eye out for a black male, the white one said. I'll let you know if I see him. It took all of Daryl's restraint not to say it aloud. He did say it with his eyes, though. The black security guard glanced away, getting the joke. The song Fuck the Security Guards from Rusty Cundiff's Fear of a Black Hat was in Daryl's Friday night mix, which he played late when there were fewer children in the store. It would be so easy to punch on the sound system and let it blast. Security guards were cops without the training or even imaginary ideals, and a whole gang of them had been hired to patrol the shopping center where Sankofa was nestled since the renovated apartment building across the street began leasing at 3 times the price. Lemert Gardens, the landlord called the complex now, although it had no garden, and the bougainvillea flowers wrapped around the fence had turned brown and died years ago. Daryl had seen these two rent-a-cops before through his picture window at the counter, their necks swiveling as they marched up and down the strip like the street was under occupation. Daryl hoped the sun was burning them up in those black uniforms that made them look like SS. About your height and weight, the white security guard said without irony. The brother still didn't meet Daryl's eyes. If you see anyone. If I see me, Daryl said. Sure, I'll give you a call. You got a card? He held out his hand. The white security guard was confused by his juxtaposition of sarcasm and willingness. He finally reached into his front pocket, behind his badge, and pulled out a business card. South LA Security, established 2016. But now his minor irritation had bloomed to anger that turned his earlobes red. When he leaned forward, he stared into Daryl's eyes almost like a lover. And that was when Daryl knew. Daryl's grandmother had called it his third eye, claiming it was his birthright. Daryl knew things that were unspoken sometimes, whispers of premonitions. His stomach always knotted when he brushed against knowledge that was none of his business, but he'd learned to use the feeling to avoid problems when he interviewed job candidates or suffered through first dates that wouldn't lead anywhere except where he'd already been. This time, the feeling was even stronger. The nodding, but also a burning. This guy was bad news, a violent bully. Okay, maybe he didn't need a premonition to guess that. But Daryl knew this particular man, Rick, his name tag said, no last name offered, was a security guard because he couldn't qualify for LAPD, which was a true testament to his instability. And he deeply craved an excuse to hurt a smartass like Daryl Martin Jones. To kill someone, if he could get away with it. Just to see what it might feel like. Even his smile looked like a trap ready to spring. Daryl pulled his hand back, hesitating to take the card. He wanted no ties to Rick. "You've got a great view of the street here," the black one said. "Maybe you'll see someone you don't know? Someone who doesn't belong?" The door jangled again, and this time a white couple walked inside, maybe in their late 20s, both in hiking sandals and cargo shorts, their toes bare, on an adventure together. They hesitated at the sight of the security guards, but after a quick assessment, they decided the space was safe. Daryl noticed how the woman drew her arms around her oversized purse. "Do you have any children's books?" she asked Daryl. "Picture books?" Daryl pointed to the colorful corner display at the front of the store with the child-sized plastic play table. Bright red, truly impossible to miss. But because his desk was so prominent across from the door, he was the concierge from the moment customers walked inside. No need to look for themselves. "Picture books up front. Most young adult books are near the back. Let me know if you're looking for something specific." "Great," the woman chirped. She seemed to notice how tightly she was clutching her bag and let it fall limp to her hip. "Just looking for something for my niece for Black History Month. This is a beautiful store." "Thank you," Daryl said, his eyes back on the white security guard. He realized he had never taken the business card, which the guard still held out within his reach. He hated the part of himself that felt more at ease with the white witnesses nearby. He even put on a show for them. "And we serve beautiful customers in a beautiful neighborhood." Daryl took the security guard's card. From Rick's icy smile, he hadn't liked waiting. Daryl hoped they wouldn't come by the store again, but the knot in his stomach, still stewing, told him they probably would. Rick would, at least. Daryl was pretty sure of that. A less watchful manager might not have noticed, but that wasn't Daryl, so he saw right away. Two books were face out in Protest and Revolution, instead of the newly published books by UCLA professors he was trying to promote. The two books facing out were Franz Fanon's The Wretched of the Earth and The Autobiography of Malcolm X. He had read both of them in high school, his first and favorites. Truthfully, they usually were facing out, but not today. Except they were. He hadn't seen a customer in that section in the hour since he'd propped up the other books, so no one else could have done it. And the two books he'd chosen were on the floor, face down, as if the two books in their place had popped out on their own and knocked down the upstart competition. Daryl wasn't a haint-believing kind of brother, so that's not where his head went first. He told himself that he must not have noticed one of the customers rearranging his shelf for whatever entitled reason, maybe a, well, actually, commentary on which books deserved to be in the section and which didn't, and Daryl was muttering about it under his breath for the rest of the day because the fucking nerve. The thing was, the only customers who had been in his store since he arranged those shelves were two white dudes who had gone straight to biography and then ambled over to the New York Times bestsellers. And then the new section at the front where he kept most of his books by white authors, decorated with big enough posters to be seen from the store window. Colson Whitehead, yes, but also the usual suspects, Stephen King, James Patterson, John Grisham, and Gillian Flynn. White nip for casual passerby who weren't drawn to the Kenty cloth and Essence bestsellers that took up most of the window space. For the first year after the gardens opened up, newly renovated, three times the price for a one-bedroom, he delayed stocking anything except black and brown authors as usual. But he had to admit that his sales had gone up almost 20% since he added the new section, maybe more if he was honest. His old customers were moving on and out, but his new customers wanted to treat him like a Barnes & Noble despite the sign clearly marked Sankofa Books and Gifts outside. Even if they didn't speak any languages from Ghana, where Sankofa meant to go back and retrieve what was lost, they should be able to tell it meant black. Daryl had studied enough sales trends to predict that if he had a time machine, he might not recognize Sankofa in 5 years, assuming it was still here, just like he already didn't recognize the rest of the street. The books and shelves might still be here, but the spirit of the place could be gone, like everything, like everyone. Daryl never planned to run a bookstore. He'd noticed how hard Mrs. Richardson worked as he strolled the aisles and vowed that he would never be seduced by a love so fickle. Too many empty seats when the visiting author deserved a stadium. Hardcover books too expensive for customers to afford. He promised himself he would not be swayed by the whine of Coltrane's sax hypnotizing him from the speaker in the top corner of the east wall. Not by boxes of greeting cards adorned with the blazing colors of Harlem Renaissance artists. Jacob Lawrence, Romare Bearden, Lois Milo Jones. Not by hand-painted placards posted to announce the myriad sections, each more glorious than the last. Protest and revolution, and biographies, of course, but also science fiction, mystery and thriller, romance, comics and graphic novels. Each aisle a world unto itself, his mother's favorite weekend spot, God rest her soul. Let me take you to school so you'll see what they won't teach you, Mama used to say. And they would each disappear into Sankofa as the hours passed outside. Sankofa was the sun on its venerated street in South Central, and everything else was in its orbit. Or so Daryl thought. Sankofa was not only a fortress from erasure. It had been a citadel during the fires. In 1992, when a jury in Los Angeles proclaimed that a black man's plight was worth less than a dog's, since his neighbor had gotten jail time for beating his dog, unlike those cops who beat Rodney King for the world to see, the strip mall across the street had gone up in flames while Mrs. Richardson opened her doors to anyone who needed to sob or rant or both behind the safety of her bookshelves. Fruit of Islam guarded the doors, but even if they hadn't, Daryl's father and his uncle Boo, both high school football coaches, would have joined any dozen other men or women to protect Sankofa and its treasures. Smoke rose east, west, north, and south of Sankofa, but not a single page in the bookstore burned. When Mrs. Richardson offered Daryl a job after school when he was 15, it seemed harmless enough. Why not earn his movie and comic book money organizing the boxes, stacking books on shelves, and, after a couple of months of building trust, running the register when Mrs. Richardson had more than one customer, so she could hover and make suggestions. He'd imagined himself becoming a writer, so a bookstore felt like a natural incubator. If he were honest with himself, and honesty was harder to come by now that he was nearly 40, his days working at Sankofa had been some of the happiest of his life. The problem was he'd fixed the store, the street, the neighborhood, in time, as if they would always be the way he remembered. But in the Afrofuturism section, Octavia E. Butler had written, "The only lasting truth is change, in Parable of the Sower, for all the world to see." So that fallacious thinking was nobody's fault but his. Everything changed. The South Central L.A. he'd grown up in had been different in his grandmother's time when it was mostly white. His grandfather used to say that the coyotes and mountain lions and bears that sometimes ventured from the hills were only a reminder that this land had never belonged to humans, period. The only lasting truth, indeed. Daryl first thought the word ghost the day the boxes tumbled down in the storeroom. The store was empty when he heard the noise, and the cramped storeroom, which housed the bathroom, didn't have a door to outside. How many times had the more celebrated authors complained that there was no rear door to sneak into past the crowd? This was about a week after the wrong book covers had been turned out, which he'd pretty much forgotten, even when the other strange things started happening. Always when he was alone. On Tuesday, the blinds over the picture window unfurled even though no one touched the pull string. The right half fell until it nearly touched the floor, but the left half got caught midway up. A leering eye. That was a first. Then the Barack Obama book cover he'd hung on the wall was on the floor when he opened the store Wednesday morning, the plastic frame cracked, Obama's face grinning sideways at him. By then, it was three strange occurrences in as many days, and he'd begun to wonder if someone was sabotaging him on purpose, low-key. Then the storeroom. Daryl had part-time helpers who came in after school like he had, although frankly, they lacked both drive and pride in their work. So Daryl checked the stability of every box himself, even if he didn't stack them. Hardcovers could get bent up in the box, and returning them was a hassle, so he ran a tight storeroom. When he heard the crash, he thought a vagrant had snuck in to find a quiet place to sleep. And instead, he found all six boxes from the top of the wire shelf on the east wall tumbled down to the concrete, one of them bashed open and spilling Stephen King paperbacks. "Hey, who's back here?" he called out with extra bass in his voice, picking up his broom because, again, he wasn't a ghosty kind of brother and the only hauntings he'd heard about were in old houses. Grudgingly, he remembered the security guard's visit and talk of a local mugger, so he thought maybe his store was a target. He couldn't guess the angle of knocking down boxes in the storeroom, but it could be a ploy to get him away from the register. He tried to keep one eye on his desk through the doorway, but the storeroom had a lot of narrow aisles to cover, so eventually his desk was no longer in sight as he peeked around corners. No one. The storeroom was empty. He was about to try to figure out what else could have made the boxes fall when the bathroom door slammed itself shut. The slam was a loud crack, like a gunshot that made him jump inside his clothes. The doorknob rattled like it might fall off, then abruptly fell still. "Hey!" Daryl called with far less bass this time, more like a petulant child. "Get your ass out here and get the hell out of my store!" The door didn't move. The doorknob didn't so much as tremble. Daryl never kept a gun in his store. He had his dad's old Glock at home, a memento more than protection. But it wasn't with him now. The notion of an armed bookseller didn't sit well with him, felt like an oxymoron. So all he had in his shaking hand was a broom handle as he approached the bathroom door. "Come on, no one's gonna hurt you," he said, trying to sound folksy and empathetic. Sometimes desperate people only wanted $5 or a sandwich. "You need something I can get you, brother?" Sexist to assume it was a man, he knew, but whoever it was would have to be pretty tall to reach those boxes on the top shelf, and strong enough to pull them down. Stillness and silence. Daryl knew that most store owners would call the police, but not on his damn watch, and he wouldn't call those security guards either. He used the hashtag #AbolitionNow on his Twitter. So this was how a world without policing would look like. People would need to deal with their own damn problems instead of expecting somebody to come help them. "All right, then. One. Two." He didn't wait for three. He turned the knob and kicked the door open so hard that he tore a foot-sized hole in the wood, which apparently was hollow inside. Shit. No one was in the bathroom, which was only as big as a broom closet with no windows. So its emptiness sat in plain view. One gray-white toilet, water low as usual. A sink with a rust trail in the basin from the faucet left dripping over the years. The mirror with a triangular crack in one corner. An old Devil in a Blue Dress movie poster featuring Denzel. Empty. "What?" Daryl said aloud to his reflection in the mirror. "The fuck?" That was the first time the word came to his mind. "I've got a damn ghost." His grandfather would have called it a haint or a spook. Whatever the word for it, his experiences in the past couple of days finally made sense. "Well, I'll be damned," he said. And just maybe, he thought, he was. The spirituality section gave him clues, but no real answers. Yet he'd pieced together enough from ghost stories and horror movies to figure out that any haint going to the trouble of being noticed by human eyes must have a message.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.